more frustrating things about the MCU, at least from a fan perspective, is that since it's now connected with Disney, and Disney has the best lawyers, everyone who's ever been involved with it is tied up in non-disclosure legal agreements, and thus can't talk honestly about things that happen behind the scenes. So what you get from behind the scenes is mostly puff pieces, and you don't find out, and you have to basically surmise what really goes on behind the scenes. And when something goes wrong, you have to dig down doubly hard, and that brings us to today's movie. The first movie that many people consider to be a disappointment to come out of Marvel Studios, but is it really? Well, we'll see. But the one thing is, exactly what people consider went wrong with it is debatable of why it happened. For instance, it's generally agreed, for everything I've read, agrees that it was a last-minute replacement that wasn't supposed to. Whether or not it was still supposed to be happen before Avengers is up for debate. But we do know that originally Iron Man 2 was not supposed to be a 2010 movie. It seems that there was supposed to be another movie in 2009, Ant-Man, but there are a litany of production problems on that that ended with the original assigned director leaving the project eventually. But at this point, from what I understand, it got pushed back, and then it just dropped off the radar. At least that's what seems to have happened. And Iron Man 2 was brought up to fill its place. Although other things that I've read suggest that 4 was originally supposed to come out in this slot, but it ran into production problems. So, who knows? I doubt it was 4, simply because I don't see how Chris Helms... I don't see what... How... If they... I never heard that they had another actor cast in that role, and it's hard to see how Chris Helmsworth would have made this work as early as 2010. I know it's only 1 year, but at that point he was just getting off of his brief role on Star Trek and some other films, so it looks like, I don't know, it just seems unlikely that he would have been able to balk up that fast. Maybe it was the reason, I don't know. But anyway, this movie begins where Iron Man left off, in that you see a dying guy in Russia talking to Mickey Rourke with a Russian accent, and Mickey Rourke vows revenge as the old guy dies, and Eddie starts, and then as they're both watching Tony Stark revealing to the world that he is Iron Man, and we learn what every superhero has known. It's a bad idea to let supervillains know who you are. There's a reason why most superheroes take a secret identity. If you wanted to see the Peter Parker character completely betrayed before World War Day, just watch the, read the Amazing Spider-Man issue where for no reason he comes out and reveals it to the press. Iron Man has to learn that lesson in this movie. Tony has to learn the same lesson Peter Parker learned. That it's stupid? Yes. This guy actually manages to build his own arc reactor. His own mini arc reactor thing is. We see that in the 2 years since the original Iron Man, it seems that Tony's ego hasn't shrunk. If anything, it's more out of control than ever. He's basically sent all the terrorists and a lot of dictators running for the hills as Iron Man, which, good for him. And he seems to be celebrating now. He declares that he's given the world his longest uninterrupted peace in decades. I might take some issue with that, since his period of peace was 2 years. Good night. If that is true, we are a horrible species. Anyway, So he's celebrating at the Stark Expo, which is basically, if the World's Fair had it, if the 1937 World's Fair had an ego, and that ego took a bunch of steroids and a bunch of weight gain powder, you would get the Stark Expo, where everybody's coming together for a full year to show off scientific advancements and collaborate on projects and just do showy stuff, like have bikini girls in Iron Man costumes dancing. Because I'm sure there was You also see that Stark's getting reckless, and he's giving away his art and everything else, and we soon find out why. It turns out something that they left out in the first movie is that the core is that he's going through the cores of his mini art reactors in his chest. His art reactor, of course, keeps him alive, but empowers the Iron Man suit. But here's the thing: the cords are made of polonium. Yeah. If you don't know what that is, play the original Mass Effect. What is the most effective ammo you can get in the original Mass Effect against organic targets? Yeah, it turns out sticking that in the middle of your chest isn't healthy, and it's killing him. He's keeping it in check. He's keeping it in check with some herbal cure drink stuff, but it's not working out that well. But he's hiding everything from Pepper, who I have to say I think actually the interplay between Pepper and Tony actually feels much more natural in this movie than it did in Iron Man 1. So that's definitely a step up in this movie's favor. And he's going through course of him fast, So, he's keeping this for Pepper, he's keeping the fact that he's dying, he doesn't expect to live more than a year after this, and what's more, Congress wants him to turn over the Iron Man suit to the military, which he is refusing to do. At hearings, he makes a joke out of their new big defense contractor since he got out of the weapons business. Hammer. Who is basically a sleazy Tony Stark. Yeah, you thought Tony Stark was sleazy? Here's the thing. At least they made it clear in the original Iron in the first movie that at least he cares enough to put some hard work in when it's needed to get his weapons working, and he's trying to come up with some, and he's not just chasing trends, he's actually trying to come up with things that'll keep people safe, that'll enable us to hunt down terrorists and other enemies easier and quicker, and eliminate enemy strongholds, thus bringing down casualties in war. Now, imagine somebody who acts just like Tony, only he doesn't care about the build quality, and he's just chasing whatever Tony Stark is doing. You've got Hammer right there. You got Hammer and Hammer Tech right there. So Tony makes a fool of them. He then goes to where he's sponsoring a race car in Italy. He then makes, first of all, he makes Pepper CEO, and the notary who comes in to finish up the legal matters, he then hires as his new PA, who turns out to be Black Widow, Natasha Romanoff. One thing that puzzles me in this movie, is that, and I hear the screenplay process was rushed, and yeah, there are some moments where you can tell, and one of them is whatever Black Widow is doing here. I mean, she's still a SHIELD agent. She's a SHIELD agent, we would know, but she's very good at remaining on point and seeing the big picture, and her job is to be there and sort of keep an eye on Tony and keep it from getting too out of hand, because all of the United States' national defense now hinges on him, since he won't hand over the Iron Man suit to the military. Okay. But she seems to do everything she can to encourage his erratic and out-of-control behavior. So she's doing the exact opposite. It's like the same problem they had with Obadiah Stane's character in the last movie. She's doing the exact opposite of what her stated goal is. Her actions result in the exact opposite of what her stated goal is. Anyway, Tony goes to Italy for a race aid event that he's sponsoring, only to take over the car, only in the middle of it he gets attacked by Mickey Rourke's Russian guy, who it turns out is the villain Whiplash. He takes Whiplash down, but Whiplash seems pretty triumphant, since on national television he showed that Tony Stark can be defeated, and now everyone is crying out, since Tony assured everyone that nobody else could develop these suits and make them work, and he had a version of the suit and its power source. Well, some random Russian guy has it. Well, you can understand people are a little freaked out, and the government is now more than ever wanting to pull the Iron Man suits away from him. So anyway, the whole thing happens. Tony flying back. He's trying to get Pepper take a vacation, even though she just became CEO and he's really left a lot on her plate. Good night. All I can say is, Pepper Potts should be sainted for the amount of patience she has in this movie. I mean, good night. The amount of garbage that he keeps shoveling on top of her that she has to deal with because he gives her a job that she didn't even want in the first place. What the? That's all I can say. The fact that she doesn't push him out of the private jet at this point in the movie really, really goes above and beyond. So Hammer breaks Whiplash out of prison to help him finish his Iron Man knockoff suits. But the partnership doesn't go exactly as planned, simply because Hammer doesn't really know what he's doing. He just wants all the press and the praise and just wants to show off. He basically wants the partying lifestyle of Tony Stark without doing any of the work that it takes to get that, that Tony Stark put in to get that partying playboy lifestyle. And the fact that he's more erratic than a dying Tony Stark, who isn't even bothering with any semblance of self-control, when he hasn't really done anything of note, it really says it all about him. And about how one-sided this relationship is. Yeah, he has a bunch of security guards on his side, there's no contest over who the real B villain is and who the A villain is. It's Whiplash. Whiplash is the A villain. Hammer is just, he's basically just funding Whiplash, and he doesn't know it at the moment. He basically exists to be a piggy bank, and that's all. His last birthday party gets out completely out of control, and the government realizes that, hey, leaving all our weapons in the hands of our biggest national defense weapon in the hands of a drunken billionaire, that might not be safe. and Tony starts randomly shooting stuff people are throwing in the air with his weapon. Yeah, yeah, that's a thing. That's safe in a crowded living room. Good night.
I'm gonna shoot that watermelon! Oh, hail the power of my Nikon transistors!
Yeah, that guy, he's not... Yeah, you really want national security depending on him. So, Rhodey comes in and takes an Iron Man suit. He gets into a big fight with Tony and then flies off with... disabling Tony and then flies off with the suit. And Pepper rightly calls out Black Widow, Natasha, for encouraging Tony to have this party in the first place. Which again, why would she do that? Her job is to keep them all on point. There's a whole thing where Tony finally meets Nick Fury again, this time in the main body of the movie, and it's revealed that there is no way Rhodes could have taken the suit without Tony allowing it, since there were all sorts of safeguards, which Tony conveniently didn't activate. And Fury tells Stark that there's another core, there's another element he can use for the core for his arc reactor that will keep him healthy, that will not kill him. His father told him about it, he just has to rediscover it. But his father hid everything because he couldn't produce the element himself because of the limits of his technology. Tony finds a video message, and again, this is the confused time strain, and I have to wonder if it wouldn't have been better if the Iron Man movies had been set in the 90s, because while it says that it says that this film was recorded in 1974, the film, the coloring of the film, the way the color works on the film, the color grading of the film, the font of the logo, and just the general design of when his father is making this film where he shows off a miniature model of the Stark Expo. Yeah, the grounds for the Stark Expo. It all looks like it's, even the style of the clothes looks like it's from the 50s, not the 70s. Yeah, there's a huge difference between mid-1950s and mid-1970s stuff. So, yeah. I have to wonder if it wouldn't have been better if this had been set in the 70s. We then see a brief cameo by Captain America's shield. Yes. At the time, that was my reaction at the time when I saw this in theaters, because I was like, Captain America movie still hadn't been officially announced, but I was like, he's always been one of my favorite superheroes, so I was like, when I saw that shield, I was like, yes, Captain America's next. And of course, we get Agent Coulson in his biggest role, so in a pretty good sized role this time, and that fervor cemented him as, and it sort of brought him a fan base that would later lead him to be what he is today, one of the few characters in history to make the transition from another medium into the comic book, that his character was originally spun off of. The other successful attempt I can think of is Harley Quinn from Batman the Animated Series, and the backstory they came up with for Mr. Freeze in that show as well. So that puts him in good company. So anyway, Tony, he finds that the model, it's the map for creating the new element. He creates the new element and gets a new charger adjusted tie because the military has done something wildly stupid and illegal. I'm pretty sure it's illegal. Okay, you might get away with, although Rhodey didn't have a court order, you might get away with, on national security grounds, seizing one of the Iron Man suits. Okay, you might get away with that. But handing it to a competition, letting the competition make modifications to it, including base code in the thing that runs the thing, and adding on all these weapons to it, and then selling it back to the United States military for a profit? No, there's no way. There is no way. So many people would be sued and in prison after this. I'm sorry, but I can't believe that you could do this to a multi-billion dollar defense contractor and there would be nothing. I mean, nobody would do business with the United States government. Nobody would develop technology in the United States if the government could just, anytime they wanted to, just seize your property, your patented property, and just give it to somebody else to sell to them without any compensation to you. Nobody would bother filing patents in the United States. Nobody would bother developing technology here. The United States, as an economic power, would be done if this is how it worked in real life. The relationship between Whiplash and Hammer breaks down once Hammer thinks that he has this new Iron Man suit that's been reprogrammed. Unfortunately, he reprogrammed it with a program made by a program that Whiplash has proven he can hack into, but Hammer's cocky because he's got drones and he's got this new Iron Man suit that he's going to show up at the Stark Expo. But then, of course, while he's doing that, Whiplash easily overpowers his bodyguards and then he calls Tony to gloat, saying that he's going to destroy Tony and the Stark family legacy by having the drones go amok at the Stark Expo, so that Stark's family will be destroyed just like his family was, because turns out Stark's father was the one who sent his father back to Russia when he discovered that he was a Russian spy, and since he had failed, he was sent to the gulag and all this lovely stuff that comes from, those great communist utopias you hear so much about. Anyway, so, yeah, and I have to say, the showdown scene in this, I like it a lot more than Iron Man 1's showdown scene. They actually do some interesting things. I mean, the idea of, like, having his friend in the lead suit leading the attack, and he has no control over that suit because it's been hacked by Whiplash, that is just great. It's big, it's full of action. I don't know what more you could want from the ending of an Iron Man movie. Everything going on, it's full of energy. And what's more, all the characters' motivations this time, for once, the characters match up, their actions match up with what their motivations are. Hammer is just trying to get rich and show off, and then he's trying to weasel out of taking any blame for any of this. Whiplash's only goal is to destroy Stark's legacy. He doesn't have a plan after that, so that's what he's doing. He just wants to kill Tony and destroy everything, so that's what he's doing, Dad. Eventually, Rhodes and Tony are able to team up and take him down, and Tony and Pepper make up. Rhodes flies off to be War Machine, and Tony is fine at the end, he's told that he'll. That they only want him as a that because of his unstable actions, he's told that they only want him as a consultant. Also, of course, we see Black Widow in action for the first time, which there's talk about a Black Widow movie. All I can say is, since this movie, I've been saying about time. Good night. There's all sorts of backstory or forward story or anything to explore. The fact that this character is mostly unknown And the fact, and some people say that she's underdeveloped in the comics too, so there isn't much to work with. My thing is, it wouldn't be the first time. I mean, I just mentioned Mr. Freeze's backstory. It wouldn't be the first time a supporting character was. And Kevin Feige, and I trust Kevin Feige to sort that out. I trust him that he won't go forward unless they have something that will actually work as a full movie. So I don't think there's anything to be worried about on that front if they go forward. You got a good actress. You got the character is established and liked. It seems like if you get the proper team in place, it's a no-brainer for me. But anyway, enough on that tangent. Sorry. Yeah, and we've been see the post-credit scene that Coulson was called away to see Thor's hammer. And, and that got me all excited. That got us all excited at the time. And, yeah. Overall, I'm going to go against popular opinion and say that I thought this was better than Iron Man 1. This wasn't bogged down by the origin story stuff that can slow it down, and the villain's motivation, their actions made sense when put together with their motivations. Even Tony's actions made some sort of sense in that he wasn't about to give up his iron, he was too proud to give up his Iron Man suit, but he knew Rhodey needed to take it, so he pushed him into a situation where he would be forced to take it. It's not perfect. It's far from perfect, but it's not bad at all. In fact, I just had a blast watching it. So, I give this movie 7.5 out of 10. It's a very fun movie, and I think it's actually kind of smarter than Iron Man 1. So, the cast is definitely working together better, so, I enjoyed it. Feel free to tell me how wrong I am in the comments.
So, we found it.